awareness about COVID through such webinar. Let me brief you today's schedule. Dear participant, as usual, our respected principal ma'am will deliver her welcome speech, and which will be followed by ethical session by Dr. Sonali Mukherjee ma'am. And after the ethical session, four most amiable faculty member of our college will handle the presentation session. They are Dr. Anindya Sundar Bhunia, Sri Ritik Acharya, Srimati Rituparna Maiti, and Sri Santanu Das. And last but not the least, perhaps most important session, the presentation session will be chaired by Dr. Shyamasri Ghosh. She had already mesmerized us by her presentation on first day of webinar. At the end of session, most dignified personality of our college, our respected HOD, Dr. Indrajit Biswas, will conclude the webinar by giving word of thanks to speakers, paper presenters, all other participants, and rest entire organizing team of webinar. Now I would like to request our respected principal ma'am to give her welcome speech for today's session. Ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Rehan Ahmed. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to welcome you all again.
Thank you, ma'am.
Before I formally go for giving my welcome speech, I must confess that I have learned a lot from these webinars. There are lots of previous webinars also, and we are conducting this 3 days webinar. And I have learned about the dedication my teachers, with which my teachers conducted such webinars. So my heartfelt gratitude and regards to all my teachers, without whose dedication such webinars could not have been taken place. All the webinars, they are very good in content and quality. Some internet connectivity problem was there, which was not in our hand, but I am really thankful, and it is a gracious moment for me to share that I am fortunate that I work with such teachers who are in true sense academicians too. I must express my gratitude to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bashop Chowdhury, who has tried to respond in all my odds. Whenever we conduct seminars, whenever we have conducted webinars, he has tried to be with us with his graceful August presence. I'm thankful to Dr. Jain, Dr. Shyamasri Ghosh, Dr. Abul Kalam, Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee, who despite their busy schedule, agreed to spare their valuable times with us. We have learned a lot from these speakers. They have shared their knowledge resources with us, and we are really being enlightened. At least a part of their knowledge we are still trying to grasp. For today's session, I'd like to welcome Dr. Shyamasri Ghosh and convey my thanks again to her, as she has given her consent to chair the session despite her very busy schedule. I'd like to thank all my teachers, Indrajit, Pradipto, Rehan, Pradeep, Pritha, Atrey, Ritik, Puja, and most importantly, the guides of these junior teachers, Dr. Rupa Sen, Dr. Lipika Mollik, Dr. Sonali Mukherjee, Professor Divakanto Jha, and of course, our non-teaching colleagues who never feel tired to provide us all sorts of help. With my respect and gratitude to our governing body president, Sri Madan Mitra, and all the respected governing body members, I'd request Dr. Ahmed to continue the session and continue the session and proceed further. I welcome all the participants, as well as I express my best wishes for the paper presenters in today's session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now I would like to request Sonali ma'am, please start your ethical session.
Thank you. Dear participants, and you know, today is the last day of our 3 days international seminar. Today I must thank our principal for her tireless effort to encourage different departments to arrange the webinar. Now I again request all participants to keep their video off and mute their microphones. Again and again I am requesting, except who will present the paper. Fill up the feedback form before 2 p.m. Feedback form will be shared in the chat box during the session again and again. You have not to worry for that. You put all the queries in the chat box, but please, 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 no good morning, no such message that I have already filled up the feedback form, etc., etc. Please do not, otherwise we will be puzzled with the query. Thank you. Dr. Rehan. Hello, Dr. Rehan.
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now I would like to request our amiable faculty members, Sri Ritik Acharya. Ritik Sarji, there?
Yes, okay, sir. Aninda. You are audible, sir. I can hear you, sir.
Please, Ritik sir, please carry on with your team.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, bye.
Hello. Now we are going to start our oral presentation session. I request Anindya Sundar sir, are you audible, sir?
Yes.
Anindya Sundar sir, please start the session.
Okay, thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are absolutely audible, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Before we start the presentation session, all the speakers of this session are requested to get ready accordingly. And I request all participants to maintain the presentation time strictly within 5 minutes. So please maintain the stipulated time, please. Now, we invite the first speaker of this session, Mr. Ashish Gorai, to deliver his presentation. And Dr. Arunima Bardhan Madam to get ready for the next presentation. Mr. Ashish Gorai, sir, are you present?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir, please start your presentation now.
Okay, 1 minute, please. Sorry, I cannot share the presentation.
It's okay, at least you just read out. Don't waste the time, please.
I cannot share my presentation. 1 minute. You can see my presentation, PowerPoint presentation?
No, sir, no.
Okay.
No, sir.
Is okay now?
No, sir.
Ritik, please help him to doing so.
Sir, you must go to the screen share option, sir. Screen share option.
Yeah, that now is probably okay. Is okay now?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir. You may carry on, sir. Yes.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. To fight with coronavirus, it is very important to know its origin and its behavior. That means whether it came from environment or it came from laboratory. It is a controversy. There is a controversy. some people think that it came from China's seafood market like Wuhan, and some people believe that it is made by some scientist in viral laboratory. So before going that, to understand the behavior of some coronavirus, we find that the global CO2 emission is contributed 30% made by China, and the origin of coronavirus is also China. So there is some link between carbon dioxide molecule and China to create this type of virus. And in some paper in PNAS, you can find that hybridization in laboratory, it will be more virulent. That means if nature created a virus, whether replacing one amino acid, two amino acid, or peptide chain, or protein, it will be less virulent. And if it is done by in laboratory, it will be more virulent. And so effect of carbon dioxide. So what will happen if there is more carbon dioxide in atmosphere? So the density of air is in STP is 1.28 gram per liter, and oxygen is 1.43. Carbon dioxide is 1.96 gram per liter. So if there is more carbon dioxide in air, so density of air will increase and viscosity is decreased, because viscosity of carbon dioxide is 1.46 Pascal second into 10 to the power minus 5 Pascal second, and for air 1.8 into 10 to the power minus 5. So if there is more carbon dioxide, the density of air is higher and viscosity is lower. So, and if the density of coronavirus, you can see this picture, if the density of coronavirus is comparable to atmospheric ingredient, then it can float. So in the picture one, you can see that if there is more carbon dioxide, it can infect one people to another people easily. And if there is less carbon dioxide, it can, the virus cannot go up to that person. So the carbon dioxide has a greater role to spreading and floating of coronavirus. In this picture, you can see there is four people. In atmosphere, the carbon dioxide concentration is 0.04 volume percent. Whether in lungs, you know that lungs can accommodate 4.5 liter air, and in there the carbon dioxide concentration is around 4.2 to 4.5 volume percent. That means the concentration of carbon dioxide in atmosphere and in our lungs is 100 times higher. And our assumption, our hypothesis is that the concentration is that the concentration of, okay, I probably unlimited. The concentration of carbon dioxide, the of those person who has higher percentage, 4.5 volume percent is higher. So it will infect that person. So the carbon dioxide concentration of a person is higher, then it will infect that person, and gradually this type of phenomena will happen. So no one will immune. Everyone will be affected by coronavirus. And this, and another hypothesis is that this type of coronavirus, there is so many things like spike protein, membrane protein, envelope protein, and nucleocapsid, and inside is genome. So at pH less than 5, it is sleeping state, and is 5.5 to 6.5, it is active state. And when we increase the pH more than 8, it will be dead. So now we can understand that in which condition it can attack. So there is some data, like some pH, why we wash our hand, not our whole body, and why it attack our nose, not mouth. So there is some literature. You can see the hypothesis and then compare this one. The saliva has a pH 6.2 to 7.6, and the nasal mucus has 5.5 to 6.5. So from the hypothesis, you see that the active state is 5.5 to 6.5. So it will attack our nasal mucus, not our saliva, mouth saliva, the tongue saliva. And there is so many parameter. You can check which you can check with this hypothesis which part can got affected by this coronavirus. And also there is some data that our body function with pH, like kidney, stomach, blood, muscle, tongue, the pH variation is 7.382, and there is some literature. You can I shared this presentation in WhatsApp group, so you can see this one. The symptoms arises of a people or infected person when the pH of that organ is decreases or increases by that amount, and the severity of condition depends on how much change is there. And the stability of coronavirus in water.
Sir, you are running out of time, sir.
Just 1 minute. And so whether coronavirus will go away or not, you can see that the soil in whole world is acidic or basic. You can find in literature. In India, it is acidic or in some basic. So if it drop into some acidic soil, so it can stay for a long time, like year, because it will go to sleeping state. And when it will come, it will got some atmosphere, then it will reactive. So it will never go from atmosphere. And finally, we are using, according to hypothesis, sodium bicarbonate solution is the or tablet you can use, because it will maintain the pH of all the organ. So a drug like which can treat the pH of all organ almost constant, that can be used for coronavirus patient. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Gorai. Can you hear me?
Yes.
That was a nice talk, but your talk focused on traditional therapeutic treatment for COVID-19 infection, as is the name of your talk.
Yeah.
So what is the traditional therapeutic treatment, do you think, or is available or WHO approved method for treatment that is being proposed at this point? Can you highlight on that, maybe for 2-3 minutes?
And I think that who misguiding people, because that is my personal thinking. So they use some sodium hypochlorite for coronavirus killing. It will damage the environment. So we can use sodium bicarbonate instead of sodium hypochlorite or some ammonia solution. So.
That's nice. Another question is that you focused on carbon dioxide, which is, you told that it is the environmental parameter that is affecting the COVID-19 infection. Is it the only parameter, you think, or there are other environmental parameters also?
There is a lot of parameters. Yeah, I have published 2 papers and one communicated another paper. So you can see the reference paper, you can get all the information, which parameter can affect and how There is so many questions and there is so many answers. Where researcher of like a smoker is less prone to attack, or how long the coronavirus will stay in environment. There is a lot of information you can find, but because the time limit is very small and I cannot explain.
Yes, I can understand. Things. Okay, that's understood. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, and thank you, sir. Next we invite the second speaker of this session, Dr. Urunima Bordhon, madam. Madam, are you present?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, absolutely.
Before moving on, I would request Dr. Ashish Gorai to stop presenting.
Okay, madam, you start, please.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I am Arunima Bardhan of Bashirhat College. I'm privileged to present myself in this international seminar, for which I'm thankful to the organizing committee of Hiralal Mujumdar Memorial College for Women. One second. Please tell me, is my slide visible or not?
No, madam, your slide is not
visible. Not visible.
Now is it visible?
No, madam.
No, madam.
Yes, now it's visible.
Okay. So I'm going to speak today on alternative therapeutic medicine against coronavirus under the sub-theme, role of traditional therapeutic treatment in combating COVID-19. Is my slide visible? Please tell me.
Yes, ma'am. Your slide is visible. You may carry on, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Now, there is a proverb, prevention is better than cure. We all know that there is no vaccine out for COVID-19 yet. And they say it won't come out until 2021. So what do? Sit back and allow the virus to infect us. Our condition will be then this, and then finally this. So instead of complaining over the unavailability of drugs and vaccine, we can very well resort to our gardens and kitchens. Since time immemorial, Indians have been relying on alternative medicine for all kinds of treatments. Now, what is alternative medicine? It is that which achieves the healing effects of conventional medicine, lack biological plausibility, and that which is untested. Alternative medicine is otherwise known as complementary or integrated medicine. Now, according to Government of India, Ministry of Ayush, there are 6 alternative systems of medicine: Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, naturopathy, homeopathy, and yoga. In the first 5 types, a variety of plants and herbs are used as treatment against different ailments recommended by Ayush. In my subsequent slides, I'm going to show you a few of very common herbs which could be mostly found in our gardens or kitchens used as treatments against COVID-19. Now, these are some of the very common herbs having antioxidant properties used in Ayurveda, Siddha, and Yunani. These herbs are used against COVID-19 as inflammatory agents in Ayurveda, Siddha, and Yunani again. As excellent immunomodulators, these herbs can fight COVID-19 and are used in Ayurveda and Siddha. Let me mention here that Tinospora cordifolia, or Giloy in Hindi, also known as the queen of herbs and abundant in alkaloids and flavonoids, boosts our immunity immensely. Having said that, let me again mention that it has been studied by Dr. Shyamasri Ghosh, who coincidentally is chairing this session. Bronchodilators are agents that relax and open the airways or bronchi in lungs. These herbs soothe the smooth muscles of respiratory tract. You all must be noticing in the news nowadays that COVID-19 is changing its symptoms in infected patients and showing symptoms like diarrhea, dysentery, nausea, vomit, etc. All these herbs mentioned in this slide act as antidiarrheal and are used in Ayurveda and Siddha. To protect against fever and pain, these herbs are able to act as antipyretics and analgesics or painkillers. The COVID-19 situation was unprecedented and has led to a condition where people have been pushed to the wall socioeconomically. This has led to stress and anxiety creeping into people's minds. In Ayurveda and Siddha, these three herbs actually are extensively used as anti-stress agents. Ayush recommends taking kadha or a concoction of several herbs found in our kitchens. This kadha in Bengali is also called kath. Before revealing the recipe of this kadha, let me tell you that Dr. Madhumita Majumdar, who is the senior Ayurvedic medical officer of Dhaniakhali Rural Hospital, Hooghly, West Bengal, recommends drinking warm water all throughout the day. According to her, kadha contains the concoction of 8 to 10 tulsi leaves, half teaspoon sunthi, which is dried ginger powder, half teaspoon cinnamon powder, 2 pinches black pepper powder, 4 to 5 raisins in 1 glass of boiling water. This should be taken 2 times a day. The last of alternative systems of medicine by Ayush is not the least, yoga. There are several asanas and pranayamas which can combat COVID-19. Some important pranayamas are Anulom Vilom, Ujjayi, Bhastrika and Bhamari. Kriyas are also part of yoga, and practicing these, especially Kapalbhati, Jalniti and Sutraniti, will avert COVID-19 from our respiratory tracts. This is me practicing Jalniti and Sutraniti. These are the references of the information in my presentation. Lastly, I believe if we follow the hygienic guidelines laid by WHO, like wearing masks properly, maintaining social distancing, washing hands regularly, disinfecting surfaces, we can definitely combat COVID-19. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gautam. That was a nice talk. You had highlighted the importance of natural remedies towards combating COVID-19. That is very nice. Now, I would like to ask you that do you know of any medicinal plant which has been approved by WHO, or WHO is kind of recommending it towards treatment of COVID-19? WHO is World Health Organization. Are you aware of it?
No, ma'am. As of now, I have no idea if WHO has recommended any of the herbs we Indians are using or the Ministry of Ayush is recommending. Thank you, ma'am.
It says that Artemisia annua is being possibly considered for treatment of COVID-19 by WHO. There is these kind of latest researches which highlights all that. Of course, okay. They have to be tested for efficacy and their adverse side effects. But yes, that is a probable thing that many countries are suggesting. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Next, we invite our next speaker, Dr. Abhijit Majumdar.
Abhijit Mukherjee. Okay,
you are absolutely audible. Dr. Abhijit Mukherjee, sir, please continue your presentation.
Good morning, everybody. And I am thankful to Hiralal Majumdar Memorial College for Women. And I am also thankful to respected Dr. Soma Ghosh, principal of this college, and also thankful to the organizing secretary and also the non-teaching staff of this college. I am choosing my topic in the subheading, a journey from cardiac disease to COVID-19, because there is a scenario when I was in 39 years old, later 6 months, 6 months before, I have gaining the hypertension and my blood pressure was 170 by 110. I am furious and going to doctor and prescribe medicine, and I am now taking medicine each and every day. And now I am only 41 years old. And after this session, I will discuss something with you all, and for the present scenario of cardiac disease and the COVID situation. And I am thankful to all respected audience. Please consider. And I am thankful to the organizing secretary for considering my abstract to deliver my speech in this international wonderful webinar. My surveying of my topic is novel coronavirus COVID-19 and its effect on cardiac disease. All of you know that COVID-19 is originated generally in December 2019 in Wuhan, China city, and now it is spreading around 185 countries around the world. So it is designated as pandemic disease in March 2020. So the situation is very tough, and we have to handle this situation day by day. Now my topic is the COVID-19 with the relation of cardiac diseases. In our body, the blood pressure is maintained by a system. This system is known as RAS system. The RAS means renin angiotensin aldosterone system. By this machinery, we control our blood pressure, or our body is controlling our blood pressure in each and every time. When blood pressure falls, or when it is reduced sometimes, it signals within our kidney, and kidney releases one enzyme is known as renin. After emergence of prorenin to renin, when renin is accelerated, it induces the angiotensinogen. This angiotensinogen and renin ultimately affects angiotensin 1. This angiotensin 1 occur with the acceleration of angiotensin converting enzyme. Angiotensin 1 converts into angiotensin 2. This angiotensin 2 is the main regulatory pathway of this RAS system. When angiotensin 2 activates, it also activates our adrenal gland, and angiotensin 2 also acts as a hormone. And after inducing the adrenal gland, when aldosterone hormone synthesis occurs, this aldosterone and angiotensin 2 normalizes our blood pressure, and it regulates the normal blood pressure condition 120 120 by 80. In this COVID situation scenario, COVID is caused by severe acute respiratory coronavirus 2. This virus, we all know the structure of a virus. It has nucleic acid. In COVID-19, nucleic acid is RNA, it is positive sense RNA, and it is enveloped by a capsid, and our outer side of the capsid, it has envelope. Within the envelope, it has spikes. Within the spikes, it attacks in the host cell. We are all the host cell of this virus. And after, when they attack host cell, they generally, there is a receptor within our cell. The receptor is known as ACE2. Its full form is angiotensin converting enzyme 2. When virus attack human body, a spike attaches with the angiotensin converting enzyme 2. When angiotensin converting enzyme 2 it attacks, generally angiotensin 2 resides within our body, in the lungs, in the heart, in the kidney or epithelial tissue. They normally regulate our lung function and our heart function. But when coronavirus attacks in our body, ACE2 is activated. And when
Time is short.
When ACE2 activation occurs, this ACE2 generally hampers angiotensinogen 2. This angiotensinogen generally minimizes our activates our RAS system. But when ACE2, that is the receptor of coronavirus, which is present in our body, it deregulates angiotensin 2. When angiotensin 2 deregulates, then vasodilation occurs. Within this vasodilation system, RAS function is induced more and more, and there are several types of heart disease occurs, such as coronary heart attack, heart failure, hypertension. These are the symptoms occurs, and this disease occurs. So doctors prescribe several types of medicine, that is ACE2 blocker or receptor blocker. These blockers generally, one way they activate our ACE2 system, and after activating the ACE2 system, they generally suppress our normal coronavirus 2 system, or in other way, ACE inhibitors block protective transmission of ACE2 blockers. So this coronavirus, when attacks our body, ACE2 level is more and more, and RAS system failure and coronary, several types of coronary heart disease occurs. So I share with you something. When you are nearly 39 or 40 age, do exercise 15 minutes each and every day, walking generally 30 minutes each and every day to avoid several types of coronary heart disease. Thank you. Thanking you all. This is my topic, and this is the COVID and coronary heart disease. Thank you.
Now the topic is open for discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Mukherjee. That was a nice talk.
Thank you, madam.
You have spoken on the journey from cardiac disease to COVID-19 and vice versa. I just have a small little question that was very nicely discussed, but I have a small little question. Are there any harmful effects associated with ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers in this context? Can you highlight on that?
Doctor, so when I am also medicine day by day, and this angiotensin blockers or AC blockers upregulate AC2, and by this way they increasing the susceptibility of the virus. In another way, ACE inhibitors or ARB blockers may potentiate lung protective function also. So it is generally nowadays unclear when we stop adding medicine or we continue the medicine. That is unclear during the COVID situation. So those patients who are getting medicine, that doctors prescribe, continue medicine, and when the new patient comes, they are confused whether this doctor will prescribe with him or her or no. This is the situation.
Okay, thank you. The other question is, can you highlight the role of comorbidity in the infection and death rate in COVID-19 infection?
COVID-19, where those patients who ingested medicine day by day, the blockers medicine, the percentage of death rate is worrying than those who do not eat such type of drugs.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all. And thank you all again here in Mozumdar College for considering my abstract. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, for your nice lecture.
Thank you.
Now I hand over the charge to Mr. Shantanu Das and request him to carry on this session. Mr. Shantanu Das, please.
Yes. Good morning to our respectable principal, madam, and all our fellow colleagues. Am I audible?
Yes, Shantanu Das, you can carry on.
Carry on.
Yeah. Good morning to respectable principal, madam, and our fellow colleagues from the Department of Zoology and from other disciplines. Now I would like to invite Dr. Meeta Havladar, if I'm not pronounced wrong, Dr. Meeta Havladar, to deliver her presentation.
Okay.
Are you?
Are you share my presentation PPT?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, wait 1 minute. It is visible, my
yes ma'am, it's visible.
Visible?
Yes ma'am.
Okay. Okay.
You proceed.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Very good afternoon. Okay. Very good afternoon. I am Dr. Meeta Hawladar, Calcutta Girls BT College. Today's my topic is health hazards due to the COVID-19 pandemic area. The COVID-19 pandemic is a straining health system worldwide. The rapidly increasing demand on health facilities and healthcare workers threatens to leave some health systems overstressed and unable to operate effectively. So, lack of different access of exercise and physical activity can also have mental health impacts, which can compound stress and anxiety to our life by the COVID-19. One of the most important factors for the introducing and arising the anxiety or the physical stress by the isolation from our social lives. COVID-19 has spread almost all countries of the world. Social and physical distancing measures on the basis of your lockdown aspects. And these lockdown aspects disrupted our normal lives. So, for this policy, brief highlights the challenges of COVID-19 has posted to both the sporting world and to physical activity and well-being of including for marginalized and vulnerable groups. This is indeed an unpredictable and unexperiencing situation and phenomena of our lives on the basis of your children's, adolescents, and adults. For the school children's and adolescents which are going to schools, these schools are closed as a part of necessary measures, and then children may no longer have that on this normal environment, and so they have less opportunity to be with their friends and get that social support that is essential for good mental well-being. For this insecurity of the food, there is a one criteria. For the insecurity of food, there are the different health hazards. Food systems in the era due to the COVID-19 in pandemic area is a crisis. And this crisis for the effect on the health hazards of our society. Widening gender gap in sharing reporting on the mental health and impacts from coronavirus. There in our society, there is a developed the disparity in our male and female genders on the basis of your parenting, caring, and sharing of our experience. Regarding older people and also those with underlying health conditions due to the COVID-19, there is a different types of psychological effects among the population on the basis of your feeling stress and its impacts. Can be particularly difficult for older people and who may experience cognitive decline on the basis of your different diseases. And on this particular different diseases, among the different diseases, cardiovascular diseases is the most important on the basis of your mental health. And on the basis of your mental health, chronic respiratory diseases, among cancer, diabetes, also included on the basis of your mental health hazard and on the basis of your due to the effect of COVID-19. So, by the COVID-19 affected our lives in the various aspects. Frustration related to the society, social isolation. Fears among the becoming sick and infections family. Fear developed for the lack of safetyness of our family. What is about the inadequate household on the basis of your supplies and medical care access? Lack of accurate information, financial loss and hardships. And another different things is fear and worry about your own health, changes in sleep pattern, difficulty sleeping or concentrating, worsening and chronic health problems, and on the basis of your different types of addiction by the alcohol or tobacco, etc. On the basis of your COVID-19, social media is it effective or bad effective on the basis of your COVID-19, their announcement, their presence, the effect of our social lives. The first one is the
ma'am, you're running out of time, ma'am.
Okay. Next, my conclusion is COVID-19 hazard is likely after a population of many countries in the geography basis is overall area. And on the basis of your COVID-19, have not done anything wrong. They deserve our support, compassion, and kindness. The COVID-19 pandemic has had and will continue to have considerable effects on our lives. Feeling under pressure is a likely experience for us and many of our colleagues. It is quite normal to be feeling this way current situation, and stress and the feelings associated on the basis of your environmental effect, and it is curable on the basis of your awareness of our society and relating the mental aspects develop the physical aspects. So thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Before I'm going to announce the name of our next speaker, I would like to ardently request them to restrict their speech within stipulated 5 minutes. Otherwise, we cannot complete our program within the scheduled time. So I'd like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Meetu De, to deliver her presentation.
Dr. Meetu De will present at 13. There will be a joint presentation at Sukarna Chatterjee. You may proceed for the next.
Okay, sir. Okay. Then I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Julie Dutto, madam. Dr. Julie Dutto, madam, to proceed for your presentation. Dr. Julie Dutto, madam. Are you ready with your presentation?
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You are absolutely audible. You may proceed, ma'am.
Respected speakers, all the dignitaries and the delegates, today my topic of discussion is the use of information and communication technologies in education to combat COVID-19. Throughout the world, more than 1.5 billion students are affected by school and university closures due to the COVID-19 outbreak. So the challenges that the educational institutions are facing is a global problem. The situation forced the education sector to lift their bases through online and virtual platform across the world with the help of information and communication technology. Information technology is the use of computers to store, retrieve, transmit, and manipulate data or information. IT is considered to be a subset of information and communication technology. An information technology system is generally an information system, a communication system, or more specifically speaking, a large computer system including all hardware, software, and peripheral equipment. Communication technology is also known as information technology. It refers to all equipment and programs that are used to process and communicate information. Professionals in the communication technology field specialize in the development, installation, and service of this hardware and software system. Educational technology refers to the use of tools, technologies, processes, procedures, resources, and strategies to improve learning experiences in a variety of settings, such as formal learning, informal learning, and non-formal learning. Objectives: to assess use of information and communication technologies in education and to improve the effectiveness of teaching learning process through online mode. Education technology is a field of study that investigates the process of analyzing, designing, or developing, implementing, and evaluating an instructional environment and learning materials in order to improve teaching and learning. It is important to keep in mind that the purpose of education technology is to improve education. One must define the goals and needs of education first, and then we should use all our knowledge, including technology, to design the most effective learning environment for students. Education technology is to improve education. Technology should assist learning processes and increase performance of the education system as it regards to usefulness and effectiveness. Instructional technology can also be seen as a process of solving educational problems and concerns, which might include motivation, discipline, the dropout rate, school violence, basic skills, critical thinking, and the whole list of educational concerns. First, the problem is identified, and analysis of the factor of the problem is made, and possible solution to the problems are presented. Then the student population and the curriculum are analyzed. The next step is to select the most appropriate instructional strategies for the particular situation. Next, the instructional material and resources are selected that are suitable for the curriculum and the mode of instruction chosen. Finally, the program is implemented, evaluated, and revised as needed in order to meet the stated goals for school improvement. Online education is a system of education where learners use their computers or mobile with the internet connection to have an access to education. Online education is electronically supported learning that depends on the internet connectivity for teachers, students, communication, and the circulation of class material. Teachers can use the online facilities of audio, video, text, animations, virtual classroom environment, and live chats. Mobile networks have been the preferred platform. Nowadays, teachers are working with the computer, various software applications, cam recorders, digital cameras, cameras, the internet, satellite, interactive TV, audio, and video conference, and so on. Today, teachers should know the use of digital cameras, scanner, cam recorders.
Madam, time is short. Please conclude.
Okay. Massive online course, MOOC platform, online courses from experts available in English, French, Spanish, Italian, and Portuguese, known as Allison. SWAYAM, Government of India has also taken initiative to digitalize education to take the best teaching learning resources to reach out to the most disadvantaged faction. SWAYAM is a program started by Government of India and designed to achieve the three basic principles of education policy of access, equity, and quality. SWAYAM seeks to link the digital divide of the students who remain untouched by digital revolution. In order to ensure best quality content produced, 9 national coordinators have been appointed. They are ICT, NPTEL, UGC, CEC, NCERT, NIOS, IGNU, IMMB, NITTR. Courses available through SWAYAM are available free of cost to the learners. However, students want complication certificate after examination is chargeable. There are certain drawbacks also. The method of learning community are familiar with the teaching learning assessment methodologies affected by the lockdown period or closure of the education institution for such a long time. Only a selected few private and government institutions could implement online teaching methods. The different and underprivileged sections have totally shut down for not having access to the online setup. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Next, I would like to invite Mr. Molloy Sinha. Mr. Molloy Sinha to deliver her presentation.
Amar awaz shunte parchen apnara?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
শুরুতেই আমার পরিচয় দিই, আমি মলয় সিনহা, নেতাজি সুভাষ ওপেন ইউনিভার্সিটির অতিথি শিক্ষক এবং আজকাল খবরের কাগজের সম্পূর্ণ সংবাদকর্মী। প্রথমে ধন্যবাদ জানাই হীরালাল মজুমদার মেমোরিয়াল কলেজ ফর ওমেন কর্তৃপক্ষকে এই সংকটজনক পরিস্থিতিতে একটি আন্তর্জাতিক মানের ওয়েবিনার উপস্থাপনা করার জন্য, যার বিষয় হচ্ছে এফেক্টিভ সাইন্টিফিক অ্যান্ড টেকনোলজিক্যাল অ্যাপ্রোচ ইন কমব্যাট কোভিড 19 অ্যাক্রস দ্য ওয়ার্ল্ড। এই আলোচনা চক্রে আমার বিষয়বস্তু দেশে বিদেশে কোভিড 19 এর বিরুদ্ধে লড়াই করতে বিজ্ঞান ও প্রযুক্তির ভূমিকা কি। শুরুতেই বলি, আজকে হচ্ছে শনিবার, হুয়ের তথ্য বলছে গোটা বিশ্বে এখনো পর্যন্ত সংক্রমণ হয়েছে 1 মিলিয়নের কাছাকাছি, মৃতের সংখ্যা 4,97,000, এবং আমাদের দেশে স্বাস্থ্য মন্ত্রকের তথ্য বলছে ভারতে সংক্রমণের সংখ্যা 5,09,000 ছাড়িয়েছে, মৃতের সংখ্যা 15,600 বেশি। এই করোনা ত্রাসে মানুষ লড়াই করে চলেছে, করোনার মতো মারণ ভাইরাস শেষ করার কোনো ওষুধ এখনো পর্যন্ত আবিষ্কার হয়নি, কিন্তু বিশ্বের প্রতিটি দেশ বিজ্ঞান এবং প্রযুক্তিকে ব্যবহার করে নতুন নতুন মাধ্যম দিয়ে করোনার বিরুদ্ধে লড়াইয়ের শক্তি যোগাচ্ছে গোটা মানব সমাজকে। 2019 সালটা আপনারা মনে করুন, ডিসেম্বর মাসে চীনের উহান শহরে কোভিড-19 এর সূত্রপাত। এরপর গোটা বিশ্বে এই মারণ ভাইরাসের সংক্রমণের প্রভাব ছড়িয়ে পড়েছে। সেই পরিস্থিতিতে প্রথম লড়াই কিভাবে করা যায়? চলতি বছরের 30 মার্চ ইউনেস্কোর উদ্যোগে 122টি দেশ 77 জন স্বাস্থ্য মন্ত্রীদের নিয়ে অনলাইনে একটি জরুরি বৈঠকে বসে। এই বৈঠকে শুধু স্বাস্থ্য মন্ত্রীরা নয়, দেশে বিদেশের বিশিষ্ট বিজ্ঞানীরাও উপস্থিত ছিলেন। যেহেতু সময় খুব কম, তাই আমার বিষয়বস্তু বোঝাতে গেলে অনেকটা সময় লাগবে, তো বিশেষ কিছু দিক আমি তুলে দিচ্ছি আমার পেপারের ক্ষেত্রে। গোটা বিশ্বে এখন কোভিড-19 প্রধান সংকট হয়ে দাঁড়িয়েছে। সার্স, মার্স এবং ইবোলা থেকেও করোনা যে ভয়ঙ্কর মোকাবিলা দেশে এবং বিদেশে ব্যবহার করে মাস্ক, মেডিকেল সরঞ্জাম প্রয়োগ করে চলেছে। এছাড়াও রয়েছে মোবাইল অ্যাপ, 3D প্রিন্টেড ভেন্টিলেটার, ডিজিটাল ইমিউনিটি পাসপোর্ট সহ অন্যান্য। এর মধ্যে উল্লেখযোগ্য মাধ্যম কিছু আপনাদের কাছে তুলে ধরছি। যেমন নাম্বার 1, আর্টিফিশিয়াল ইন্টেলিজেন্স। এটি সঠিকভাবে যদি প্রয়োগ করা হয় তাহলে কোভিড-19 সংক্রমিত খুঁজে বার করতে অনেক বেশি সহযোগী হবে এই বর্তমান সময়। দ্বিতীয় পয়েন্ট হচ্ছে রোবোটিক সলিউশনটা কি কাজে লাগানো হচ্ছে? হেলথ ওয়ার্কার, রিসার্চার, সরকারি এবং বেসরকারি সংস্থায় খুব বেশি সহযোগী হবে এই রোবোটিক সলিউশন। ইতিমধ্যে ভারতের বেঙ্গালুরুতে 40 হসপিটালে করোনা রোগীর স্ক্রিনিং এর জন্য মিত্রা রোবট ব্যবহার করা হয়েছে। এছাড়াও ইনজেন্ট রোবোটিক্স, সি অ্যাস্ট্রা রোবট, ট্যালি রোবট, রোবোটিক ডগ, যা এখনো বিশ্বের নানা দেশে ব্যবহার শুরু হয়েছে, হয়তো আগামী দিনে আমাদের দেশেও এই প্রযুক্তি কাজে লাগবে। হচ্ছে 3 নম্বর পয়েন্ট, অ্যাপ এবং টেস্ট কিট। ইতিমধ্যে ভারতে করোনা ট্র্যাকিং এর জন্য আরোগ্য সেতু তৈরি হয়েছে এবং কাজ শুরু হয়েছে, এটা আমরা সবাই জানি। এছাড়াও স্মার্টফোনের মাধ্যমে GPS এবং ব্লুটুথ ব্যবহার করে করোনা ভাইরাস রোগীকে ট্র্যাকিং করতে সাহায্য করে এমনও অ্যাপ উন্নত মানের অ্যাপ তৈরি করেছে, যা ইউরোপের ইংল্যান্ড, ডেনমার্ক আরো উন্নত মানের অ্যাপ তৈরি করে এরা কাজেও লাগাচ্ছে। করোনা রোগীদের জন্য আমেরিকায় তৈরি হয়েছে হোম টেস্টিং কিট, যার নাম পিক্সেল। এছাড়াও হচ্ছে রোবোকক্স কনভিক 19, RT-PCR টেস্ট। সিঙ্গাপুরে ইতিমধ্যে হচ্ছে মিরেক্স নামে একটি টেস্ট কিট শুরু হয়েছে। সবথেকে উল্লেখযোগ্য আমাদের ভারতবর্ষে তথা আমাদের ওয়েস্ট বেঙ্গলে GC বায়োটেক ল্যাব নামে একটি কোম্পানি খুব সস্তায় 500 টাকায় টেস্টিং কিট তৈরি করে ফেলেছে। সব থেকে উল্লেখযোগ্য আরেকটি পয়েন্ট আপনাদের কাছে তুলে ধরবো, সেটাকে ড্রোন এবং মাস্ক। বিশ্বের অনেক দেশে GPS, GIS এবং মনিটরিং সিস্টেম, ড্রোন ব্যবহার করে কোভিড-19 এর পরিস্থিতি মনিটরিং করা, পাশাপাশি ড্রোন ব্যবহার করে সংক্রমণ ঠেকাতে কেমিক্যাল ছড়ানো এবং অতি সংকটময় এলাকায় ওষুধ বিতরণের কাজে ড্রোনকে ব্যবহার করা হচ্ছে। পাশাপাশি বলি মাস্ক, বর্তমান সিচুয়েশনে মাস্ক হচ্ছে একটি উল্লেখযোগ্য ইকুইপমেন্ট, কিন্তু এই ইকুইপমেন্টকে বিশ্বের নানা দেশ নতুন নতুন ভাবে ব্যবহার করছে এবং নতুন নতুন ইকুইপমেন্ট তৈরি করছে। যেমন ইসরায়েলি বিজ্ঞানীরা ইতিমধ্যে 3D প্রিন্টেড মাস্ক, এমনকি রিমোট কন্ট্রোল মাস্ক তৈরি করে তাক লাগিয়ে দিয়েছে। লাস্ট যে পয়েন্টে চলে আসবো, যে ভ্যাকসিন এবং আমাদের দেশে হোমিওপ্যাথি প্রয়োগ। আমাদের দেশে সব থেকে উল্লেখযোগ্য যে যারা রাখছে যে ভ্যাকসিন তৈরি ক্ষেত্রে জাইডাস ক্যাডিলা এবং সিরাম ইনস্টিটিউট ইতিমধ্যে তাদের কাজ শুরু করে দিয়েছে। এছাড়াও বিশ্বের আমেরিকা, চীন সহ অন্যান্য দেশেও এই ভ্যাকসিন তৈরি করার কাজ অনেকটাই এগিয়ে আছে। সর্বশেষে চলে আসি হচ্ছে হোমিওপ্যাথি। এই হোমিওপ্যাথি ইউজ কিছু কিছু ক্ষেত্রে অনেক বিতর্ক থাকলেও কিন্তু অনেক কাজে, এবং একে অ্যাপ্রুভ করেছে হচ্ছে কাউন্সিল অফ রিসার্চ ইন হোমিওপ্যাথি কাউন্সিল। আর এর পাশাপাশি শেষ কথা বলি যে আমাদের দেশে লকডাউন, এই লকডাউন নিয়ে অনেক বিতর্ক থাকতে পারে, কিন্তু অনেক বিশেষজ্ঞ বলছে এই লকডাউন সামাজিক ভ্যাকসিনের কাজ করেছে আমাদের দেশে সংক্রমণ ঠেকাতে। যদি সঠিক সময় সঠিক সিচুয়েশনে যদি লকডাউন ব্যবহার না হতো তাহলে আমাদের দেশে আরো বেশি সংকট তৈরি হতে পারত। নমস্কার।
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার, থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার। নেক্সট আই উড লাইক টু hand over the charge of announcing the names of our rest of our honorable participants to my fellow colleague Ms. Rituparna Maiti from the Department of Zoology. Rituparna madam. Rituparna madam, are you ready?
Rituparna, can you hear us?
Rituparna madam, am I audible? Hello.
Hello, I am audible.
Rituparna, please carry on. Please carry on.
Audible, I am.
Yes, Rituparna, you are audible. Please carry on. Please call our next participant.
Okay. Good morning to our respected principal ma'am and Dr. Shyamashri Ghosh and all my fellow colleagues and all of the participants. Our next participant will be Mr. Nurul Alam. Can you hear me, sir? Mr. Nurul Alam?
Yes, I am. I'm ready.
Okay.
Yes.
Is there any problem?
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Am I audible? Audible?
Yes.
Mr. Alam, you can start your presentation, sir.
Hello.
Hello, you are audible, sir. Please start.
Hello. Ma'am,
hello.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Okay. And good morning to all. Good morning to all, and thanks to the principal ma'am. She is really very active and enthusiastic. And also thanks to all the participants and organizer also. Now I am going to present my paper. Outbreak of COVID-19 and its post-pandemic effect. And the discovery of coronavirus and this pandemic coronavirus COVID-19. Initially, the discovery, coronaviruses are a group of a large family of virus that can cause illness like cold, fever, and the respiratory tract infections in mammals and birds. These types of coronaviruses were first discovered in 1930. The name corona has come from the Latin word, which is meaning crown or halo. It appears crown-like two-dimensional picture and with cover around cloud shape, mainly of protein spikes. It is constituted by single-strand RNA genome. some important coronavirus outbreak in past, SARS, the severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus was first identified in November 2002. SARS is one of group 2, also group 2 beta coronaviruses, only mutate frequently and infects new species. SARS infection was outbreak in about 29 countries. SARS has also spread worldwide by the respiratory transmission, such as droplets of coughing and sneezing, etc. It was spread in about 29 countries, such as North America, Europe, and other Asian countries. About 8,098 people were infected and 774 deaths. MERS, the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus. It was first reported as a new strain of human coronavirus causing severe pneumonia and appeared in April 2012 in Saudi Arabia. It was reported officially in May 2014. This type of beta coronavirus was closely related to the bat coronaviruses and also of HKU4 and HKU5 coronaviruses also. It was spread in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Jordan, and Kuwait. It was transmitted into the travelers to Egypt, Tunisia, Germany, Italy, Great Britain, Malaysia, Philippines, and the United States. Responsible for lower respiratory infection with common cold. Recent outbreak of COVID-19, which is a pandemic to our scenario. The origin of this pandemic coronavirus was early originated in Wuhan, China in December 2019 as a SARS coronavirus 2. It infects humans to have been originated from bats. The mutated form of SARS, SARS, is to be formed as SARS coronavirus 2. Its common symptoms of pneumonia with cough and cold with sneezing, etc. After infecting the host cell, its strain affects into upper respiratory system in human bodies. Different organs and system of human bodies gradually come into sedentary that may be attempt to be death. It was outbreak and on 7th January 2020 came out genomic sequence of this recent outbreak coronaviruses. This virus is to be characterized as spherical shaped single strand positive sense RNA virus with helical symmetry.
And, sir, time is short, sir.
Two beta coronaviruses. It was named 2019 coronavirus in the World Health Organization WHO, and it was on the 12th January 2020. This newly identified coronavirus is made by polymers of glycoprotein projected over the envelope in the crown-like shape like other coronaviruses and its spike proteins. Modifications all of its level of spikes on receptor binding molecules are responsible for outspreading and mutated of this species. And 11th February 2020, World Health Organization by the International Committee officially announced the name COVID-19. This is the table and chart, very important chart. This is the sum of countries I have seen.
Sum of countries. Sir, your time is already over,
China,
sir.
USA, Spain, Italy, UK, Germany. This is here. The infected total population and infected persons and death on as on the 25
sir, please conclude your session.
25th June 2020, yesterday, yesterday and the last day, it was the China infection of China. It is the
population
116,312.
Sir, your time is over, sir. Sir, your time is over.
Is the respected of this infection is 18:1. After this, USA 142, 142 is the one. It is infection.
Sir, please conclude, sir. Your time is over,
and
sir.
The death is in, from the infection is 19:1.
Sir, please conclude. Please conclude.
It is visible.
Nitik, I think we are not audible to him. Call him.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Dr. Rehan, sir.
The
Rehan, sir.
USA. USA.
Yes.
Sir, can you call him?
Yeah. I call him. Yeah. And Dr. Nurul, sir. Am I audible you? Nurul, sir. I am audible to you.
Yes, sir.
Please conclude, sir. You have taken enough time. Please conclude.
One minute. Okay.
Please, sir, conclude as much as early.
This is infection rate and death rate is low and highly death rate we are visible and. And post-pandemic effects are social effects, some of social effects, mental depression, hypertension, bad headache, etc. And postponing of obstacle celebration like party of wedding, birthday party, etc. And the effect in education is very important now. And after different other of effects, medical effects, economic effects, and also the fake news, intolerance, violence, etc. is come out and only some benefits. There are huge time of busy person. She can contribute, he or she can contribute time of some creative way and can utilize the time.
Please conclude, sir.
To come closer, etc. And thank you. Thank you to all.
Okay. Okay,
I
would call upon the next speaker, Srimati Pritha Ghosh. Ma'am?
Hello, ma'am. I'm audible.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, ma'am, just a minute. I'll listen.
I request all of the participants to consider the time limit, please, for while you are presenting. Please consider it as we are running short of time.
Is it visible, ma'am, my PPT?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Today I'm going to present my topic, Health Benefits of Curd, a cost-effective traditional food to improve immunity during COVID-19 pandemic situation. Myself, Pritha Ghosh, MSc Applied Nutrition, NIN, ICMR, Hyderabad. Introduction. COVID-19, which turned into pandemic situation, became a major public health concern worldwide, mainly in low and middle income countries. This infection divided into three stages: asymptomatic incubation stage, non-severe symptomatic stage, severe respiratory symptomatic stage with high viral load. And impaired immune system causes increase in viral load, leads to lung tissue inflammation due to pro-inflammatory responses by macrophages and granulocytes. Strong immune system is one of the best weapon to deal with the situation. It helps to reduce the viral load and prevent the disease. Rapid recovery within short period of time. makes a person less prone to frequent infection. My main focus is in gut immunity. The mammalian gastrointestinal tract is the largest immune organ, which is the primary site of interaction between the host immune system and pathogens. Gut protects the host from undesirable pathogen by establishment of the physical barrier, chemical barrier, and immunological barrier. Changes in the composition and activity of the gut microbiota affect immune responses. Purpose for using probiotics. According to FAO, probiotics are defined as live microorganisms which administered in an adequate amount confer health benefits on the host. Certain species such as lactic acid bacteria and bifidobacteria are commonly used for manufacturing of probiotic products. And benefits are, it activated local macrophages, increased immunoglobulin A production, transport antigen from gut lumen to Peyer's patch to stimulate the activity of specific and non-specific immunity, reduce the growth of pathogenic bacteria in the gut by producing bacterial proteins, bactericidal proteins, short-chain fatty acid, organic acid, antimicrobial compounds, and decreasing luminal pH and pathogen attachment. It also increases the intestinal barrier function and compete for nutrients with pathogen. Probiotic curds and its health benefits. Curd is a very popular fermented milk product which converts lactose to lactic acid. In India, approximately 7% of milk used for consumption as a curd, and curd play an important role as a probiotic because live microorganism contain it deliver healthy bacteria directly to the large intestine. Advantages are, it suppress harmful bacteria and stimulate the growth of beneficial ones, and probiotics present in the curd are able to survive the passage through the digestive system, produce vitamins, especially B vitamins and K, and it is safe for lactose intolerance patient. It have high antioxidant activity, better protein digestibility, bioavailability of some nutrients such as calcium than milk. It also easily available and inexpensive. Then some strategies to improve the beneficial effect of curd. Use of prebiotic, those are non-digestible foods, mainly soluble fiber, which helps to grow the good bacteria in the intestine and keep beneficial bacteria healthy. Food sources are mainly vegetables, fruits, whole grains. Curd should consume within 12 hours of fermentation at room temperature. Curd should also consume daily and sufficient amount, minimum 50 grams per day. Use various recipes to prevent monotonous diet. Consume with fruits and flaccid powder. Try to use toned milk for better antioxidant activity. Last, I would like to conclude that in this COVID-19 pandemic situation, it is very essential to boost the immune function to cope with the situation. But foods like curd plays a good role in as an immune booster, because it cannot increase our immunity overnight. It is a long-term process. But change in the dietary pattern by including curd in our daily diet may contribute improving human health. Thank you.
Thank you, Pritha. Now, our next speaker is Shankholita Sarkar. Are you ready, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes. You are audible.
Namaskar. A warm welcome to all the respected dignitaries and the participant present over here. Just a minute. Should I start? And my PowerPoint presentation is visible to all of you?
Yes. Yes.
I am Shankholita Sarkar, and today the topic of my discussion is COVID-19 vis-a-vis lung cancer. The condition associated with the SARS-CoV-2 virus has been named as coronavirus disease or COVID-19, and it was declared as a global pandemic on the 11th of March 2020 by World Health Organization. As reported to WHO, these are the confirmed cases and the deaths in global scenario, and in India, more than 15,000 people are dead because of this scenario and this virus. As the entire world continues to fight against the severe acute respiratory distress syndrome like coronavirus 2 is responsible for COVID-19, the pandemic continues to escalate at a rapid pace and throwing unprecedented challenges to medical facilities and the healthcare infrastructure in every affected countries, from developed to developing. The four reasons behind the comorbidities due to the COVID-19 scenarios are hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular problems, and cancer. The worst outcomes of COVID-19 in older people are the cancer patients is hyperinflammation due to the immune cell activation. And as aged patients are present with the immune compromised state, therefore a major consideration in providing cancer care during this pandemic is to balance the risk of patient exposure and infection with the need to provide effective cancer care treatment. In a study from China, it is clearly depicted that much higher morbidity and mortality due to the composite endpoint of ICU admission related issues due to the ventilator care and lack of healthcare assistance, etc. kind of things. The vulnerability of cancer patients due to COVID-19 are many. I like to highlight three of them. Cancer patients are always much more vulnerable to infection due to the malignancy itself. Secondly, the effect of the delay that are bound to occur due to this COVID-19 outbreak. And lastly, those with the cancer may well suffer under the altered concept of priority, which I termed as a new normal kind of thing, but it is actually a huge mental pressure for the cancer patients who are in very limited kind of resources and needed the critical care of things. So the most interesting and important cases in this case of lung cancer is particularly is there is overlapping profiles and symptoms like cough, shortness of breath, which is quite similar to pneumonitis and lung cancer and COVID-19. So the central concept of the treatment can be performed accordingly, and there is a severe immunopathophysiological kind of things in case of COVID-19, as seen the slide. I skip this slide because of the limited time limit. You can clearly see that this is a resident macrophage, and what is happen and what will happen in case of COVID-19 kind of outbreak. It is a cytokine storm, and macrophage activation in case of COVID-19 attack in case of affected individuals. And there is an overproduction of macrophages and the cytokines, which generally disrupt Yes, exactly. The central concept of the treatment can differentiate it into three kinds of thing, that is non-small cell lung cancer, small cell lung cancer, and the neuroendocrine treatments. And the common surgery treatments of the cancer is surgery, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and immunotherapy. These are the clearly depicting scenario. And in case of, this is kind of interesting thing, in case of early stage of non-small cell, if the lung nodules are more than 2 cm, surgery is required. Less than 2 cm, surgery should be deferred. Adjuvant therapy is kind of things we can be considered considering the scenario. Locally advanced non-small cell cancer, multidisciplinary curative approach, and concurrent chemotherapy is to be needed, and in case of metastatic type of things, oral pill like tyrosine kinase inhibitor is urgently needed, and palliative surgery is to be done to ensure the quality of the life of the patient. And lastly, in case of neuroendocrine things, these are the management profiles. These are all my references, and thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shankurita Sarkar. Now I request Shrihiti Gacharjo sir, please.
Without wasting any time, thank you, Ritupona. Thank you, everyone. I now want to call our next presenter, our next participant, Mr. Shaukat Ali. Mr. Shaukat Ali. Mr. Shaukat Ali, are you here with us?
His microphone is mute, I think.
Yes, Mr. Ali, you are audible, but your sound is little faint.
Now, sir, is it audible, sir?
Now it is okay, Mr. Ali. You may carry on,
yes,
sir. You may carry on, sir. Your time starts now. You may carry on, sir.
Okay, sir. Sir, screen is visible, sir.
No, not yet. Not yet.
Not yet, sir. Just a minute. Just a moment, sir. It's taking a time, sir.
Yes. Shankulita Sarkar, please mute your microphone now and your video also. Your screen is now visible, Mr. Ali.
Your screen is visible, sir.
Your screen is visible. Now you may start.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yes. Your presentation is also visible. You can start now.
Okay, sir. My topic is real-life information and communication technology in education in India and abroad during COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19 has sanitized whole educational system of the world in the number of special level school, college, and university level education have affected a lot, as school, college, and university level education provides the right direction to the students' community to build up their career. As of May 2020, number of students already affected due to closure of school throughout the world is approximately 1.268 billion. According to the UNICEF, number of countries have implemented nationwide closure of school colleges is 177, and the number of countries have implemented local closure is 13, which has a direct and indirect effect on the 73.5% student population of the world. Information and communication technology based school, college, and university level education is an essential need of the hour. Main idea behind introducing ICT in education: any technology which increases the rate of learning would enable the teacher to teach less and to learn the learner more. Worldwide research has shown that ICT can lead to improved students' learning and better teaching methods. Objective of my study, the researcher has tried to show the impact of ICT on the study of students during COVID-19 pandemic situation. To understand the necessity of technology-based education and to make aware of the urgency of ICT-based education during this crisis. Research methodology. the prophet does not intend to build a new theory, and it is based on available secondary data. For the purpose, researcher has collected data from different books, articles, research papers, internet webinars, conferences, etc. For the purpose of the study, all student has been studying at primary, secondary, high secondary, college and university level have taken into consideration. Target group. ICT is essential for meaningful interaction between learners and educators in education. Educators are defined here to confer is primary, secondary, high secondary, college and university teachers who facilitate learning. Influence of ICT in learning. ICT helps to promote interactive learning experiences. ICT stimulates and motivates students to learn. ICT provides comfortable learning. ICT helps in the understanding of difficult concepts and process. ICT caters to different learning styles. ICT helps students to gain valuable computer skills. ICT aids in collaboration and group work. Relevance of ICT in teaching. It has the capability and potential to make teachers more sufficient, more capable, more competitive, more updated, more social, etc. In the following ways, it makes teachers' task of teaching more easy. It enables teachers to help students to retain the learned material for a longer time by involving multiple senses of students like touch, visual, and auditory. It helps teachers to present their teaching material in a systematic way by using PPTs. It helps teachers to record their lecture by availing records so that the students may listen to them as many times as they wish to understand the matter clearly and deeply as per their needs. It improves teachers on campus and off campus, on campus and off campus communication with the students by offering a variety of mediums of communications like instant messaging, social media, email, video conferencing, etc. to suit their needs. It makes learners the teaching process economical in terms of time, money, and energy by providing mic, speakers, and CDs, projectors.
Sorry, you are running out of time.
Sir, time is short.
Okay, sir. I think I am going to a conclusions part. Information and communication technology based education is an essential need of the hour due to COVID-19 pandemic situation, as nobody knows when education institution will begin the teaching learning process. Again, the researcher has advocated for an emergent need to develop the prevailing teaching system and to change the mindset of the teachers, students, parents, and other personnel involved in education at school, college, and university level so that ICT-based education can be implemented as wider scale. And we all know that today, for the sake of the COVID-19 pandemic, we are all here. That's all. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Shaukat Ali. Our next participant is Shipra Modok. Shipra Modok, ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Ma'am, you may proceed now.
Okay.
Your slide is visible, ma'am. You are.
This is not my slide, actually.
Okay.
Oh, this is my slide. Presenting, sir. Yes.
Mr. Ali, please start presenting.
Okay.
Okay. Yes.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, all the delegates who are present over here. My name is Shipra Modok. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. You are absolutely audible.
Okay. My name is Shipra Modok, and I am working as a senior lecturer at Government College of Nursing, IDNBG Hospital. And I am there for about in this profession for about 15 years. So I will be today I will be sharing my thoughts regarding the sub themes of. Are my slides visible?
No, ma'am, it is not visible. No, ma'am.
Please give me a few minutes.
Yes, your slide is now visible, ma'am. Your slide is now visible.
Thank you, sir. So I would like to offer my thanks to all the organizers of Dr. Hiral Mukherjee Memorial College for Women to allow me to share the screen on this platform. So I will be directly going into the sub-theme of my topic, that is respiratory complication of COVID-19. So these things we already know that severe, so far the discussion that has been done by these 2 days, there we know that severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, SARS-CoV-2 is a novel type of virus, and it is of beta genus with, it has got severe pulmonary or respiratory involvement. And COVID-19 primarily infects the lung in the affected individuals, and about 1 in 6 will have the complication, including that are very life threatening. So what actually this SARS-CoV-2 does on the lungs? We will have a look at the picture, and we will try to understand so that it will be better to understand the complications or respiratory complications of COVID-19. So we know that the virus gets its entry through the eyes, the nose, or even through the mouth, and it enters via the larynx, enters to the trachea and enters ultimately to the lungs, and at the lowest unit of the lung, that is the alveolus. This is a larger picture of an alveolar. So normally in a healthy individual, what happens, there is oxygen transfer between the RBC of the capillaries or the blood vessels and the alveolus, where the RBCs are getting the oxygenated blood oxygen, and they are carrying this oxygenated blood to the internal organs of the body. This happens in a normal individual. Now, when the person is getting infected with SARS-CoV-2, then the virus will be there, reach up to the level of, in some of the patient, it can reach up to the level of the alveolus. And when it will reach in the alveolus there, then we have certain inflammatory responses which will be started. And this is called as immune response. There is a cell which are called as type 2 cells which will come and which will recruit the macrophages. These macrophages are fighting against the virus or bacteria. So macrophages will be recruited, and whenever there will be immune response, the permeability of the cell will be, blood vessel will be increased, as there will be vasodilation. So the macrophages will enter and it will release the cytokines, and it will enter into the alveolus where the virus is there, and they will fight, and because of their fight there will be a debris production, which are actually the protein like substances, and also the fluid production. So as there is debris and fluid into the alveolus, so normal space or normal layer of the alveolus is getting thickened, so adequate amount of oxygen cannot be transmitted to the blood vessels so that the RBC can supply it to the different internal organs of the body. As a result, the person will have difficulty in breathing and the body will suffer from oxygen. And in severe cases, you see in this picture, there will be more and more accumulation of fluid, protein rich fluid, when the body is not having the capability to fight against the virus, and it will less the space between less the space of the alveolus, and that those tissues which are already fight against the bacteria, they will heal, and they will be there in the space as the scar tissue. This scar tissue will more thicken the wall, and there will be more difficulty to transfer the oxygen into the RBCs, and there will be difficulty in breathing. So this is the problem what the patient will be presenting with. This pathology, let us see what are the respiratory complications the patient may be presenting with. First category is mild symptoms or mild illness, or it is also called as uncomplicated illness. In most of the patients, so far the studies that I have gone through, I have done a mean, and from there I have seen that 80% of the people will have mild illness. Well, while they will have only respiratory tract infection, upper respiratory tract infection, where they will be presenting like fever, cough, sore throat, there may be nasal congestion, malaise, headache, etc. Then next category is pneumonia. It can be categorized again into two. One is mild, another one is severe. In mild form.
Hello, madam. Time is almost over, madam.
Achha,
time is almost over.
Okay, I am trying to finish. So So in mild symptoms, there will be cough and difficulty with breathing. In severe symptoms, there will be suspected respiratory infection. The person will have fever, and the SpO2, that is the partial pressure of oxygen into the blood, that is seen by a machine which is called pulse oximeter, will be lessened, and it will reach to less than 90%, which is normal. Normal level is 98 to 100%. So it will reach to less than 90%. In the next category, when the person will develop the next complication, that is acute respiratory distress syndrome or ARDS, these problems will be worsened, and the person will be presenting with these all worse symptoms from more than 1 week, and there will be problem with the lung imaging, like X-ray, like the USG of the lung, and the CT scan of the lung will have the abnormal reports. Next complication is acute respiratory failure. It is also reported that about 17% of the patient is having acute respiratory failure. In a study in China, it was done, and it was seen that out of total 400 patients, there was 38 patients who died because of the acute. Acute means sudden. Suddenly, there will be loss of oxygenation and oxygen and carbon dioxide transport between the cells, and the patient died as the one. And the last complication is the pulmonary thrombosis. This is also seen in few patients in China only, and it is accumulation of blood. Accumulation of clots into the pulmonary capillaries, and due to this, the death may also occur. This happens mainly with the patient who has sepsis. Sepsis means infection in throughout the organ or throughout the system. So we do general.
Ma'am, you must conclude now, ma'am. Okay, your time is already over.
Okay, so in management, we are giving general treatment, oxygen therapy, and we are giving respiratory support. So this is about my topic. Thank you all.
Thank you. Our next participant is Ms. Sukanya Chatterjee. Sukanya Chatterjee, are you here with us? And it's a joint presentation from Gurudas College along with Dr. Meetu De. Sukanya Chatterjee.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes, Sukanya, you are audible. You can start your presentation.
A very good afternoon to my honorable delegates and fellow students. I, Sukanya Chatterjee of Gurudas College, have got the golden opportunity to present a joint paper with my teacher, Dr. Meetu De, and I would like to talk a few words about classroom hygiene in the post-pandemic era of undergraduate science students. To start off, I would like to ask, when is the post-COVID era? The world is presently at such a state that no one can tell when we will actually get over the current pandemic situation. Knowing not from when a proper treatment for the deadly virus will come to being, we are being advised to cope up with the new normal. We have to accept this new normal so much so that we will have to carry a bottle of sanitizer as essentially as a bottle of water, and we will have to forget sharing is caring. Therefore, instead of calling it a post-COVID era, we shall call it a post-lockdown era when the educational institution reopen. There will be noticeable change in the lives of all people associated. Ache classroom ache chok, ache teacher er bok bok. This will surely turn to a myth. Possibly a delayed start. Colleges like Boston University have already mentioned that they may delay their campus opening till the fall of 2021 if health experts still advise social distancing measures by the end of summer. The typical college student has 4 to 5 classes each semester, but they could change for the upcoming school year. Instead of semester-long courses, professor may limit their courses to 3 or 4 weeks in length. Students can complete courses in a much shorter time frame and take up to 8 blocks in a year. Depending on how each college adapts to this plan, the courses may become more affordable. Tiny in-person classes. Future first-year students can also know what to expect at college if they see an announcement about a reduction in in-person classes. The few that meet in classroom will likely have a smaller class in size. Virtual classes is already a better alternative. With the situation, even for skill-based learning, demand for skill-based learning will outweigh the classical degree courses, as I thought. Now, how will be tomorrow's practical classes? In near future, there will be a total makeover in the laboratories. We cannot share any equipment as we used to do earlier. We cannot share papers, obviously not papers, we cannot use papers as well. We cannot share anything. Obviously the cost will increase, but we cannot share. Safety is first. The libraries are to be digitalized. Already, Calcutta University has put up a digital platform, but each college must digitalize their libraries because we cannot afford to lend books any further. New fabric trends will come into existence. Easily washable clothes like cotton clothes, shoes that cover the toes well, gloves, new trendy things may be worn, and the college should allow the students to wear them inside the college premises as well, because that is a safety measure. For the next few months, we will not be able to go to canteen like we used to go before. Instead, vending machine will be installed perhaps. We will have to use it by sanitizing our hands each time. And it is a human touch thing. No person will be needed to operate it. We will be using it. With all these discussed points, our mental health might go down. Calcutta University has already started online course counseling program. Students should avail that, avoiding social stigma.
Sukanya, you are running out of time. Please conclude first.
So, lastly, this is an unprecedented situation, and we have to survive it anyhow. And how much it difficult it may seem, we have to survive. So.
Okay, thank you, Sukanya. Our next participant is also a joint presentation, Dr. Kothakoli Bondopadhyay and Mr. Kaushik Chatterjee. Kothakoli ma'am, can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You are absolutely audible. You can start your presentation now, ma'am.
Yes, sir. I will be sharing my screen.
Sukanya, please, you may leave now. Ma'am, I think you can start now.
Okay. Very hearty good afternoon to every person present here, and obviously the chairperson. My topic is the precedent of online medication during post and pandemic crisis. Are my slides visible, sir?
No, slide is not visible.
Slide is not visible.
No, not visible. Slide. And speak a little bit louder.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, slide visible?
No, not the slide is visible, but the sound is all right.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm starting and I'm just walking on the slide so that it could be visible.
Okay, good.
Okay. My topic is assessment of online medication during and post-pandemic crisis. It's a joint paper of me and my husband. Now, basically, online medical consultation is the very new concept which has become most significant, especially in this pandemic time. This term mainly indicates a very good internet-based medicinal practice. It is often considered as internet-based remote patient-doctor medical consultation. Now, the very term remote consultation, it definitely refers to those type of consultation where the patients definitely live in remote areas and need a dire need for the purpose of diagnosis or treatment. The main area is of my paper is online medical consultation, which is now offered by many providers nationally and internationally with definitely diverse features. The COVID-19 pandemic crisis and lockdown have brought drastic changes in the traditional processes of various products and services, specifically in the modern world. The major impact on the society was of the health industry and medicinal facilities, as one of the speakers was previously saying about the FMCG and the medical products, which have been of danny during this COVID pandemic. The main objectives of my study is to study and analyze the modalities of online medical consultancy and to study the attitude of both doctors and patients with their family towards its acceptance and use. The various methodology, I'm not going into the details. Here a sample survey has been taken of 75 people through random stratified method. And the survey sample has been bifurcated into three distinct groups depending upon their ages. The main specification of my paper is it's a concept which goes beyond the common telemedicine practice, which are not at all limited to specific categories of patients or for only specific diseases, or for serving people within specific geopolitical regions. I've done a SWOT analysis, which truly says about the strength of this online medication is that the rapid linkage between the provider and consumer's demand, obviously there is no fear of contamination, and obviously easy solution for minimal illness symptom. As far as the weakness is concerned, it is the issues regarding the safety and quality of the online service, lack of technology savvy people, still believing in the age-old concept of healing and touch. Obviously, it creates a great opportunity of a new business. People in need will always avail this opportunity and easy medical premium and of less price. Obviously, a threat once again to the competitive market with various upcoming private call centers, free medical visiting teams on call by certain medicinal companies, with that of controversy within public and private hospitals. As far as my response is concerned, it is being found that the frequency of surveyed respondents, 25% of the population do search for their online remedies of their physiological and mental problems. About 22% of the respondents often search for their self-cure. It is this focus group of people who will definitely move for online treatment, especially during this pandemic. Now, as for the satisfaction level is concerned, about 46% of surveyed population has experienced an informative doctor consultation, as said, or rather believed as my survey through the Google Forms, with 21% of them showing a very positive response to a prompt service. However, 33%, obviously we know a little bit of superstitious people are there, especially those who believe still in touch therapy, often remain baffled of whether to follow an online consultation or not. Now, it is true that even today, most of the Indian community are often confined within the age-old concept of PVDC, that is personal visit to doctor's chamber. The age-old concept obviously prevails along with the modern accomplishment. Thus, though 31% of the people think it to be very expensive, 30% of the people think it to be very affordable. A survey was also conducted on an at-a-call service where it has been found that most people prefer emergency service at a call, as well as ambulance, first aid, RMO service, and etc. I'm going into my findings and suggestion. Now, obviously, it is true. We all know that this is a new concept and the facility is being very much new towards the Indian scenario. And obviously, it requires a more insight to establish a local contact. Now, there are various factors which do affect this facility, like availability of internet service, recognition of the doctors, whether there will be a process of reimbursement system if the patients are not at all satisfied with the present scenario, and et cetera, et cetera. It is true that one must analyze that these services require a constant support, both from the providers and the consumers' part. Now, since ONC providers and consumers are more autonomous than conventional telemedicine, there is a need for their quality, which is need to be evaluated using innovative criteria that are adopted for this unique nature. Obviously, laws coming up, and basically it must have a professional legal ethics and financial system, obviously need to be modified for such as Google Pay and all kind of, you know, internet banking system in order to create a proper environment for the growth and at the same time to ensure a high satisfaction level of both patient and clinical satisfaction. Now, obviously, it's a new avenue for consumer choice and an open market space for healthcare provider models. And definitely, we require a great investigation in the field of research with many unanswered questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all the participants. Dr. Banerjee.
Hello, Ritik. There are two questions for Kathakuri. Can you ask?
Yes, ma'am, I'm listening.
Online medical service can never prevail over physical diagnosis in critical cases. Do you agree or not?
Obviously, I do agree. There is sometimes that it is true that online medical service can never prevail over physical diagnosis. But specifically in cases of the pandemic situation or an emergency situation, it is sometimes we do require, like if a person is suffering from any kind of chronic diseases, in that moment, it is very difficult for that person to move out, specifically in this time. And definitely, at that particular reason, I think each and every doctors will suggest a kind of online services.
Yes, yes. Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Hello.
Shall I proceed?
Yes,
hello.
Shall I proceed?
Yes, please. Yes, please proceed.
Hello. Can I explain it once again?
Yes, you can. You can. Please.
Okay, actually this is only for the purpose where the medication is done based on the diagnosis of the pathological reports, etc. So people need not have to go move from one place to another and wait in the nursing homes or in the hospital system for a long time. So this is, we have seen many, even yesterday there was a case where the person did not physically examine the patient, but based on the complete diagnosis was done on the pathological reports and the past reports and the present situation, what he is going through. So the medicines were given accordingly. So we have mentioned it only for medication purpose, not for physical diagnosis.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Kaushik Chatterjee?
Yes, I am Kaushik Chatterjee.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all the participants. Now it's my humble request to Dr. Shyamashree Ghosh, Honorable Chairperson for this session. Ma'am, kindly, if you kindly summarize and conclude the session. Ma'am, can you hear me? Am I audible to you, ma'am?
Yes, sir, you are audible. So am I, think I am also audible now.
Yes,
so,
yes, ma'am, absolutely, yes,
I have heard the session, it was very nice, and actually it had different dimensions, it had different things, because there were traditional therapeutic treatments, then there were discussion on classroom hygiene, there were discussions on information communication, role of science and technology in India abroad, and outbreak of the COVID-19, health benefits of CARD, which is the probiotic, and I think that was very nicely explained, that how the gut microbiome has a role to play in developing immunity, as well as there was diverse domains on discussions like in role of information technology and communication technology in the education in India, which is very nice and very appropriate at this point of time, because yes, when we are moving towards a new normal in the post-pandemic situation or the post-lockdown condition, then definitely these are certain important things we have to think over, and there are a lot of restructuring which has gone into every part of our lives almost, and there were other topics like respiratory complications in the study of safety of nutrition, as well as assessment of online medication during and post pandemic crisis. Yes, actually there were different domains, and all the domains were very nicely discussed by the participants, and they have done a very nice job. My difficulty is to mark them and to give them their appropriate whatever marks they deserve. So it was interesting to listen to them, and they have put in their thoughts. That is very nice, as well as a lot of awareness has been spread to the listeners, the students who have been listening it. I hope they had a lot of questions in their mind, a lot of ideas they must be bubbling with, and they must think it over. And these are very new topics of research. They can actually think how well to put in their ideas here, because the students, as I keep telling, are our future of tomorrow, and definitely they are the ones who has to take up the lead role and come up with new ideas, be it in health, be it in hygiene, be it new technological approaches in the communication or medical sector or online treatment, etc. So I think they are the ones who should be most inspired from these talks. They should take home lesson should be there for them, and that is, I also wish all the best to all the participants in their future endeavor, and thanks to the principal ma'am here, as well as the organizing committee for inviting me for the talk, as well as sharing this session. I hope all the best to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you for being constantly with us. We can't express our gratitude in words. Now I hand over to Dr. R. Ahmed, sir. Ehan Ahmed, sir. Sir, please continue, sir.
Thank you very much, Ritik. And really, thank you all the participants. Really, they have given their best in spite of some internet issues and risk technical problem. Now it's time to call our respected HOD sir, Dr. Indrajit Biswas, to please come and conclude the session by giving a vote of thanks to all the participants, including our organizing team.
Hello, hello, Ritik. Am I audible properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You are absolutely audible.
Honorable chairpersons, respected principal madam, our most valued all the participants, my beloved students, and my fellow mates. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this prestigious webinar. I, Dr. Indrajit Biswas, head of the Department of Zoology, Hiralal Mazumdar Memorial College for Women, Dakshineshwar, Kolkata, as well as convener of this webinar, on behalf of our college and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all the honorable speakers, participants, and paper presenters of 3-day session who blessed us their presence and took out valuable time from their busy schedule. I am very humbled to say a big thank you to Professor Bashop Choudhury, Honorable Vice Chancellor, West Bengal State University, for allowing his precious time for our webinar, and he enlightened us through his valuable inaugural speech. Excuse me. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to Dr. Somashri Ghosh for her speech on first day session and chairing today's session so beautifully with her skilled hand. I want to express my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Jain for his very, very resourceful presentation on second day. We also acknowledge our gratitude to Dr. Sushmita Mukherjee and Dr. Abul Kalam, for his wonderful lecture in yesterday's session and dispersing valuable knowledge from their knowledge bank. I would like to express our gratitude to Sri Madan Mitra, president of our college, and other respected governing body members for their moral support and inspiration. I would like to express our profound gratitude to our principal madam, Dr. Soma Ghosh, for her continuous moral support, guidance, and inspiration at every step since the beginning of the planning of this webinar to at this final moment too. I would like to thank Dr. Rupa Sen, IQAC coordinator of our college, for her guidance and continuous inspiration. I would also like to thank Dr. Lipika Mollik, bursar of our college, for her inspiration and giving vote of thanks at first day sessions. I would like to express gratitude to Professor Divakanta Jha for his meaningful vote of thanks on second day session. I would like to thank Dr. Pritha Kundu for her wonderful introductory speech on first day session. I want to thank Sri Pradeepto Mukherjee, convener of the seminar subcommittee of our college, for his moral support and deliberation of introductory speech on yesterday's session. I would like to thank my friend Dr. Pradeep Das, Teachers Council Secretary of our college, for always extending his helping hands to us. I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. Sonali Mukherjee for her endless effort by acting as a moderator of every day's session. I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to the entire team of our technical experts, Sri Ritik Acharya, Department of Botany, Srimati Pooja Das, teacher, Department of Computer Science, Srimati Atrayi Banerjee, teacher, Department of History, for their endless effort towards the grand success of this webinar. I would like to express special thanks from the core of my heart to my beloved junior, Dr. S. Rehan Ahmed, joint convener of this webinar, for taking almost all the responsibilities, and he worked hard to make this event very much successful. I would like to extend special thanks to rest of our faculty members, Dr. Anindya Sundar Bhuiya, Srimati Rituporna Maiti, and Sri Shantanu Das, for giving support, and I have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of dedicated colleagues of my department. I would like to express thanks to all the beloved students from different institutions as well as from our institutions for their active participation at such a web platform. I would like to express sincere thanks to all the paper presenters for sharing their new views. Like, I am very happy to know the funda of carbon dioxide on spreading COVID-19, and many other interesting topic and so on. I would like to express my gratitude and thanks to all the teachers and non-teaching colleagues of our college for their cooperation and active support. Once again, I thank all for your cordial cooperation. Thanking you. Thanks all. Hello.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, I hope that there are any questions going on in participant mind regarding the certificate. So as far as concern about the certificate, we will share our views when or how to publish the certificate shortly in a WhatsApp group. So just be with us till you receive the certificate. Thank you very much for being with us, for part of this event. Now we all are leaving and request you leave us. Thank you very much.